Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. Welcome to New Veterans Stadium and opening day. And thank you, because above all the festivities, the response that you have shown proves that Philadelphia has the best fans in the National League. On behalf of the Philadelphia Phillies, we thank you very much.
A ballpark is more than just concrete, steel, and turf. It's a storehouse for the collective memory of a whole city. For millions of kids, it can be the opening page in a lifelong love affair with baseball. For millions of families, it can provide a subtle glue to bond the generations. This is the story of a very special ballpark, Veterans Stadium.
The place to play baseball in the National League. We had a winning environment, winning teams, great players, great fans.
It's hard to think of the Vet without thinking of the fans. You just got the impression that they enjoyed coming to the ballpark. It was a great experience for them.
It was amazing, and this was, to me, the Mecca. This is where you came. This was our church, and we loved it.
We didn't come in and leave here any one day without having fun. And I can honestly say that for 32 years, that there's not a day that I haven't had fun here. It's been a great ride.
What follows is a trip through all the great and not so great moments in the Phillies' history at the Vet. You'll see a lot of wonderful memories. You'll meet some real baseball characters, including many lifers, people who've been working at the Vet since the very beginning. It's a story told by the people who lived it. My name is Bill Giles. I'll be your host for Field of Memories.
So make yourself comfortable and let's go out to the ballpark.
It was a dream that actually began in the 50s. The Carpenter family wanted to bring the Phillies out of old Connie Mack Stadium into a fresh new state-of-the-art ballpark.
My father purchased a tract of land over in New Jersey, which did put some pressure on the city to make the move and create a new stadium, which eventually became the Vet.
It was decided that the new stadium would be built in the wide open spaces at the southern end of Broad Street.
So I remember when there was nothing here, no ballparks, no anything. So it's like seeing a flower grow. I've seen all these stadiums blossom from swampland. So it's incredible.
Anticipation was soon building.
When I drove by here many, many times, it was just, look at the size of that thing against the old ballpark in Connie Mack Stadium.
I mean, it looked like a gigantic castle is what it looked like at that time.
Connie Mack Stadium, we have very few people in the front office. We have 11 people full-time year-round type of thing. And dummy here, we need a lot more people. So they brought in a consultant to work at my end of it, and we increased our sales office and marketing department and so forth. It was a whole new ball game.
The Carpenters brought me to Philadelphia in 1970 to help put people in the new ballpark. I had established myself as a marketing and promotion specialist with the Houston Astros and was very excited about the challenge of trying to fill the new Veterans Stadium. It soon became clear to all those in attendance, this was no longer going to be a typical day at the old ball game.
We can direct your attention to the right field corner, coming in direct from Montreal on dog sled.
And in the Phillies bullpen, a certain young man had some very unusual duty.
I don't know exactly what I was doing down there, but I was down the right field line waiting for the signal to tell the dog sled driver to, go ahead, send the dogs and bring Jim Fanning in on the sleds.
It's a hit off the bat of Larry Boas. Dog cuts it off. Now the first hit. Veterans Stadium, and it goes justifiably to Larry Boas.
Don Money slammed the first home run ever hit.
It's a great trivial question because it comes up a lot, and a lot of people say, "Oh, you hit the first home run in the Vet." I said, "Well, yes, I did, and it'll stay until they tear it down."
Final score: Philadelphia 4, Montreal 1. historic day in Philadelphia baseball history.
It was a great way to start the history of the Vet. And while the team had yet to show they were ready to contend, Phillies fans got their money's worth with each trip to the new stadium.
I just remember the colors. The seats seemed right. There was enough extra stuff, the dancing waters and a home run display. It seemed to feature the Liberty Bell and a cannon.
A new state-of-the-art stadium looked like a flying saucer sitting there, you know, a 60,000-seat stadium with AstroTurf, cutout bases. Beautiful, beautiful ballpark.
A lot of people probably don't remember the two scoreboards, the one in left and the one in right field that are down now. They had Phil and Phyllis, the water fountains in center field after a home run and the fireworks and things like that.
I never thought a stadium could hold that many people. When I walked in that stadium, it was unbelievable.
All the extras, all the intangibles, made it seem, you know, this is someplace new and fun and exciting.
I view the Vet as a wonderful place. I mean, I started coming to games when I was in my mid-20s, and you know, it's carried me through most of my adult time as a fan. And Midge and I got married July 10th, 1971. I better get that right, 1971. And there was a twi-night doubleheader versus the Expos. We came up after the wedding, got to the first game around the second or third inning. I remember Bill Stoneman pitched for the Expos in one game. And we probably left, you know, people thought we were crazy, but we left about the sixth or seventh inning of the second game. So, you know, the Phillies are associated with my wedding night as well.
I always felt that a day at the ballpark should feature more than just a baseball game. One of the first changes was a new look to the game day personnel. Rosie Ron was there from the beginning.
It was Bill Giles' idea that we should hire all these young women to be usherettes. It would be a nice new look for the stadium. We decided we would send out announcements to all the area colleges. We thought it would be a great part-time job for college students, high school students, anyone over the age of 18 who wanted to come and work at the ballpark.
I was right out of high school. My first assignment was the 700 level. And I had to go up. I don't do heights. And I had to go all the way up to the top of the 700 level to wipe somebody's seat. And they didn't even give me a tip.
In the summer of 71, hot pants became the fashion rage. And we created a kind of elite squad of usherettes called the Hot Pants Patrol.
My sister and I both went and applied. And we tried the uniforms on, and then Bill Giles handpicked us.
The uniforms that the usherettes and hot pants people and all those people used to wear were always fun to watch. The high boots, the 70s. Remember the high white? Oh, man, it was great.
We were wearing white plastic boots in August, and we were in double-knit, one-piece, basically jumpsuits that didn't allow it to breathe.
I do have my original uniform. A lot of people probably have them put away, but nobody has the white boots anywhere.
We really had a lot of fun. Everyone really liked one another. It was a very, very happy, exciting time.
One girl in particular caught the eye of our third baseman.
So she always tells a story about, you know, I sent a note to my buddy to tell her I wanted to take her to Chris Short's party. I did tell her that summer, or shortly after that, cancel your dates for the rest of the summer. She didn't go for that too much.
But I did.
Yeah.
Bonnie and John were married the following year. In 1972, the Vet had its first superstar.
I think we can all remember the fantastic performance that Steve Carlton put on in this stadium in 1972. He won, I think it was 27 games. That year, the Phillies only won 59, so Carlton roughly won half the games.
We started out pretty good, you know, coming over in 72 and having that really, really good year for the Phillies.
127 that year, of course, the Cy Young winner, he had a consecutive game winning streak. It was just something. And the team really responded and played well behind him.
Not only did the players get psyched up when he was pitching, but everybody in the ticket office had to be on the top of their game too, because you knew that we were going to do 15,000 walk up that day.
As a kid, this was like our playground, and we loved this place. I mean, you could come in on a Sunday, 50,000 people here, and 20,000 were kids. It was the best. The hot dogs with the stick, where they put the mustard with the stick, and the soda had the saran wrap on top of the soda. You remember the smells and the peanuts and the stale beer. Every spring, never forget, always the one thing you always did was you made the lineup out. And I'd be in like history class. And like Sister Teresa would smack me with a ruler, with something, using my bang, because I'm writing the Phillies lineup, and I got the rotation down. For my birthday, it was never fair. My parents would get me a game plan for the Phillies. It usually was a Sunday package. I said, this is great, except I don't need it because I can sneak in for free.
The 72 season also featured one of the most hair-raising events in Vet history, as the great Carl Wallenda performed his skywalk between games of a doubleheader.
That was probably the all-time scariest thing I ever saw at a ballpark.
I watched nervously as the 67-year-old circus performer downed two beers and headed up to the tightrope.
Wish Wheeler was working with me at that time, and we both went in our office. We didn't have the guts to watch this thing.
To see the width of that cable, that probably was no more than 2 inches wide, and to know that what he was going to do.
I was up on the catwalk when he took that first step out, and to look down and see where this guy was headed. And, you know, you picture the wire as being just kind of straight across. Well, it went way down and then way back up the other side.
I wasn't one of those people down holding the rope tight like our ground crew was.
We're on the guide rope. We're holding these tethers to the ground, and, you know, they're yelling at us. This manager's just screaming at us to keep things steady. And it's like, but we're doing the best we've fed. Our training was all of like 3 minutes, you know?
I was doing a between games interview with Whitey, and he is asking me, what are you going to do if something happens here? Are you going to play the second game?
I envision Phillies being on Action News that night with Wallenda dying at the bat.
You know, when he came off, they took him right to the press club. He had three martinis.
He came into the press room and ordered scotch.
And then we found out when he makes his crossing successfully, he has like three martinis. If he knew he was holding those ropes, he would have had them beforehand, I'll tell you that.
For somebody to do what he did at his age, Carl Wallenda was the greatest show I've seen here since I've been here.
In the early years, baseball at the Vet was not championship caliber, but fans were able to catch a glimpse of the glory days to come. Exciting players like Larry Boa and Willie Montanez captured our attention. In 1974, Dave Cash arrived from Pittsburgh and seemed to breathe a new confidence in the team.
He came in with more enthusiasm than anybody I've ever seen. I thought I had a lot of enthusiasm, and you know, people were saying they were picking us fourth and fifth, and not a very good team, still young, and he kept saying, we can do it, we can do it. Every day he'd come in, we're good, we're better than they think they are, we're gonna show the world.
And the big left fielder made each at bat an adventure.
First time I ever hit one here in the Vet, and went in the upper deck, and you know, it seemed like it was going to be easy.
Nobody hit as many into the upper deck as the Bull.
A young third baseman came on the scene and looked like he might be a player. that confidence came winning. And with that winning came fans. Baseball was back in Philly, and the Vet was the place to be.
Throughout the 18 years that I played at Vet Stadium, it was the place to play baseball in the National League. We had a winning environment, winning teams, great players, great fans.
You know, being on good teams and having players come up to you and want to come here and play.
What defined Veterans Stadium was the fans that filled the seats.
You parked your car, and you'd see all the kids from South Philly on their bikes would stop by and say hi to you and talk to you, and you'd sign a couple of baseballs or autographs, and they were really, you know, really good kids.
I remember emerging out of the tunnel to see the field and just remember the excitement of the first game I went to. Actually, I think it was in 76, and I sat up in the 500 level with my dad, and Mike Schmidt hit two home runs that game.
Get a chance to meet a lot of people on a lot of different levels, and especially at social functions, somebody will say, hey, this is Dan Baker, the Phillies PA announcer. Well, since people aren't accustomed to seeing my face, only hearing the voice through an amplified PA system, a lot of times I can see in their facial expression, I don't know, because I'm talking like in a regular speaking voice, not amplified through a PA system like at Veterans Stadium. And I can see this quizzical look, and I'll say, well, say somebody for me. And I'll go, now batting for the Phillies, number 19, left fielder Greg Luzinski. And they'll say, yeah, you're him. Oh, thank you, you know.
Now, I always believed that the opening day of a baseball season was special, almost like a national holiday. When I first arrived in Philadelphia, I didn't sense the same feeling from the locals. My mission was to change all that. How? By staging a series of wild and wacky promotions designed to remind the fans they were here to have fun. First, there was Kite Man.
And there's six of us from the ground crew on either side of this ramp. And this Kite Man's going over his final instructions. He says, now I'm gonna go down this ramp, and he's got all these guide ropes hanging off.
And he said, if I holler to you that I'm in trouble, jump up and grab the guide wires.
Mind you, Kite Man putting his life in teenagers' hands that are making $7 a game. A game, not an hour, a game.
Kite Man came by me doing about 60.
Whoosh! All you see when he passes us, another rope, another rope. And we're like, see ya.
The next year, he had at least made it as far as the outfield turf. And while the boos rained down, at least we all had something to laugh about. But now the challenge was on.
For showman Bill Giles, the question was how to top his opening acts of previous years. The answer required 424 feet of steel-reinforced cable. On this cable would ride Cycle Man.
This was a hot, humid night, and the moths were not only dive-bombing huge, but they were all around, flying around the whole stadium, and one came down and flew right into Lefty's left ear.
And he took a spaz. We thought Lefty finally snapped.
And I watched him start to shake and pound his head with his, going like this.
He started going crazy.
Grabbed him, we pulled him up to the training room, set him on the table, and Don Seeger proceeded to take a tweezers and pulled the moth out of Lefty's ear. But in the meantime, from the time it happened all the way up to dugout, you've never seen a man go so crazy.
I left my home in South Philadelphia in 1971 with two bad knees and the dreams of becoming a major league groundskeeper. I thank God that dream came true.
In many ways, a major league ball club is a lot like the circus. If you follow the comparison, then the grounds crew are definitely the clowns.
It was Bill Giles' philosophy at the time, and Bill was our executive vice president. And Bill said, I want you to work hard, but I also want you to have fun. And that wasn't something that he had to say twice to the ground crew.
I told me a long time ago, life's one big Benny Hill movie, so they gotta have some fun.
In the early 70s, the ground crew always had room for a certain honorary member.
We would sit behind the glass. I'd sit there with the ground crew, and I found it more conducive to umpiring from that position. And
he was a real big fan. He would curse and holler, and you know, and he was a typical fan. He hated to see the Phillies lose.
One night there was a controversial call, and one member of the ground crew, he shall remain anonymous, although he still is here. He starts banging on the plexiglass window.
And I smacked the glass. The umpire turned around, and when he turned around, he saw me, and I'm there shaking my head.
And the umpire comes back and starts pointing, but he was pointing at me.
See you later.
But nobody ate up AstroTurf like Gary Maddox. Coming in to take away a sure hit, a roaming deep against the fences, Maddox simply outran the ball.
I'm willing to say that I probably covered more ground out there than any athlete to come through the vet, and I enjoyed every minute of it. You got true hops every time. If you had good speed, you could cut off the balls in the gaps there. I really like playing at the vet. You know, some of my best memories are how I used to stand out in center field and challenge myself to get so close to the infield that I could hear Larry Bowa and Dave Cash give one another the infield signals, and then be able to go back and cover the rest of the ground there. You know, you kind of stayed out there and said, all this territory is mine to cover. I think I knew just about every inch of that AstroTurf.
In 1976, the eyes of the world were on Philadelphia as America celebrated its bicentennial. We decided to try a new look around here as well. You know, spruce up the old grill a bit. It was all part of a huge party we threw in July as the Phillies hosted the All-Star Game.
Bill Giles did an excellent job of arranging for the other cultural institutions to be a part of it, had a nice party, had so many out-of-town visitors that walked away with good feelings about Philadelphia.
The fans got a great show as five Phillies made the squad. The National League dominated, and we all saw a brief glimpse into the future.
Yeah, we used to drop golf balls down at home plate and try to knock a three-wood out of Veterans Stadium. And I remember that Mike Schmidt could do it, and I did it, but it took quite a few shots. And in the meantime, a couple of bad ones would hit the scoreboard and knock some lights out or go up into the Sunoco sign. But that was a lot of fun.
Eric Gregg is a native Philadelphian who proves that even an umpire can have feeling.
My first game in Philly was October 3rd, 1976. It was unbelievable. First of all, tickets. People want tickets. I remember they wanted so many tickets, I called up and said, you got to get permission from Bill Giles. I said, what do you mean? He said, you're over 30 tickets, Eric. So he says, what are we going to do? Open section off and call it the Soul Bowl? And I had everybody, and my mom, everybody. In fact, when they played the National Anthem, my mom stood up. They played a song for my son. I said, Mom, that's the National Anthem. Everybody went nuts. I was so nervous. I mean, I was scared. I turned white. I was scared to death. I walked to the field, and I saw these future Hall of Famers. And I'm there, there's like 40,000 people at the vet. And Lefty comes with that big curveball. Boom! And I said, for what? And I got a great catcher. Booney was catching for him, thank God. Everybody always say McCarver's the best catcher, but Booney, it was the best shot you're ever going to see. Booney says, okay, now, are you ready now? I say, I'm ready. And Lefty won the game, 2-1. I had 14 strikeouts. My strikeout was even big back then. Nobody said a word. I don't know how I got out of it, but nobody said a word.
One of the most popular features of the vet in the early days were the giant scoreboards in left and right field. In the days before Fanavision, they were the primary source of information and entertainment in the ballpark. And the scoreboard room was probably the most fun place in the organization to work.
Between Denny Lehman on the scoreboard and Paul Richardson behind the organ, as he still is, and with myself at the PA mic, I mean, we try to get the crowd involved.
And we have these giant boards with lots of lights, and it really had made impact because the boards were so close to the fans that as soon as they lit up, people would, you know, immediately their eyes would go to it.
You used to have to take the attitude that it was live TV, and once it happened, if there was a mistake, it was over and you couldn't go back and fix it.
We used the personalities of the players and their names and their nicknames. Like Greg Luzinski, we made him sort of into this Arnold Schwarzenegger kind of guy with giant muscles and a strong like bull. The key to running a scoreboard, in my mind, was the anticipation of the action and what was going to happen.
A batter hits a long drive into one of the gaps in left center or right center. Right away, it starts to click in your mind, right? Here comes a possible auto Maddox or a secretary
right,
of defense, right?
Right?
So at that point, what do you have to do?
And I just have to be ready like this. And it's automatics. You'd all of a sudden get this kind of unusual hiccup sound in the room, and you realize that the whole computer system had gone down, which meant everything had to be loaded in again. All the stats had to go in again.
Scoreboard room was a fun place. I actually, in the early 70s, I shared responsibilities with Chris Wheeler.
Just being in that room and just, we were isolated unto ourselves. I mean, we used to get in all kinds of trouble with the stuff we put on the scoreboard.
I didn't get a lot of direction per se, but I got a lot of rope.
Paul Owens fired us one night, called over there and fired all of us. He didn't like something that we had put up there. We had a little bit of the devil in us up there. And Paul Richardson was next door to us. One of my jobs was to hit a button in the scoreboard room to stop him. In fact, to this day, I walk by him and go, "Hold it!" And he.
So when things are a little slow, that's when Paul Richardson takes over at the stadium keyboard. Nobody in town knows more about the psyche of Philadelphia baseball fans.
It's the ethnic things that they can clap their hands to. That seems to get the best response. But the situation isn't right. You got a tie ball game. It's too tense yet.
Can you listen? I made a career out of those four notes. Da 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 da. Do da. Well, it's six notes, but
nothing. They're not with it yet.
Baseball is the only major team sport without a clock. And it also bends to the whims of Mother Nature.
The center field. Oh, the throw is wide, cut off by Remminger, cutting the score.
They're going to get him off.
Get that call from upstairs, you know. It's raining at the airport, you know.
We always looked at it as your parents always told you weren't allowed to play in the rain. And now it was our job to be out in the rain, so why not play now?
Now, going out there and dealing with the rains and the winds, you know, I tell people we look like idiots trying to deal with that wind.
Everybody should pull a tarp once or twice in their life and understand just what a tough job that is and how heavy that can be.
Yet rain delays can have a kind of charm of their own.
During rain delays, we'd go up in the tunnel and watch those trucks that would, you know, kind of suck the water up off the field.
And then the city had a Zamboni driver who would drive around with this big vacuum cleaner is basically what it was. He would suck up the water, and then you would cross your fingers and hope that he would put the water in the drain.
So loud. It hurt your ears. And, you know, for some reason, I liked it.
Sometimes a rain delay can be the cause of a most memorable night at the ballpark, like that incredible evening in 1993.
It was a doubleheader, and there were over 5 hours of rain delays. They finally get the first game finished. The second game didn't start until who knows when, after midnight probably.
This would be a bad hour for most folks, Harry. This is the shank of the evening for you and most of us. I mean,
oh, yeah.
3 o'clock in the morning. Hear the chimes go off.
The bars were closing, and all these people knew this was happening, and that team was a lovable team anyway, so they were coming down, and it got louder and louder and louder the later it got.
Hundreds of thousands of people are going to say they were here. It is just bizarre.
Here comes Mitch Williams. He could literally win his own ball game here.
swing and a base hit to left center field. Hank Amelia's going to score. This game is over. On an RBI hit by Mickey Poe. The Bells have won it 6-5-10 on the Wild Things RBI hit. Can you believe it?
But Veterans Stadium was pretty famous for the streakers that would run onto the field.
And there had been some in other ballparks, and everybody's trying to think of, well, what could you play if a streaker, sure enough, a guy jumps out of the right field stands wearing nothing but a pair of cowboy boots, and he runs all the way around the field. And I had the foresight to have that Peggy Lee song ready. It was called Is That All There Is?
Rain can also play a somber note in the stadium's history. Like the dark night in October of 77, when we lost the pennant to the Dodgers. The game was started in a steady rain, and our ace, Steve Carlton, could never get his rhythm. But it was the game before that clearly illustrated the agony and ecstasy of a city in love with its team.
It was October 7th, Game 3 of the LCS versus the hated Dodgers. With Carlton set to pitch the next day, a Phillies win would almost guarantee a pennant. As the game started out, the Phillies fans again rose to the occasion. They rattled veteran pitcher Bert Hooten so badly, he had to leave. Dodger great Dusty Baker remembers the scene.
Bert was a little, you know, I got a little flustered, it was ball after ball, and I was like, oh no. Oh, and the fans were all over us.
What they were doing was getting to Bert Hooten. You know, he couldn't throw strikes because there was just too much happening.
The Phils and Dodgers always played each other tough, and this game was no different. But with a two-run lead with two outs in the ninth, it looked like money in the bank for the Phillies.
Sour moments here at the stadium was the Manny Mota fly ball, which is probably remembered more than in the history of Veterans Stadium is one of the big things.
And then, as luck would have it, Larry Boa made one of the greatest plays I ever saw a shortstop make. Hard hit ground ball off the glove of Schmidt and caroms to Larry Boa, who reacts instinctively and so quickly and throws. He grabs the ball, throws almost in one motion to Richie Hebner, and looks like he's out. He's called safe.
Wait, I'll still contend that, you know, we got robbed. He was out.
Davey Lopes was out at first.
Davey Lopes, I don't know about that. I thought he beat you by a stride.
But those two losses were really tough for this franchise because, again, we thought we were a quality club and one deserving that year.
Marketing whiz kid Denny Lehman had told me about some chicken thing in San Diego and suggested we try the same idea. I thought he was crazy, but decided to humor him.
After, I guess, my second trip to San Diego, I mentioned to Bill Giles, I said, you know, the Vet has, there's a real opportunity here for the Vet to extend its in-game entertainment a little further by maybe adding a mascot to our mix. And we kicked it around for a while, and we hired an outfit called Harrison Erickson out of New York City, who designed a costume. And we felt that there was really only one person who could really fit in that costume, and this was a young intern.
I still say I was low man in the totem pole. Bill says he saw some idiocy in me that was beneficial to the project. Basically, I was the one kid that would say yes.
He fit right into that costume as if it was something that was built just for him. And I will say that the Philly Fanatic clearly was the creation of David Raymond.
Well, I mean, I was young and stupid. It was a dream job. By then, I was just having a blast. It was so much fun. And like Richie Ashburn would always think that I was getting away with murder. He thought that I had carte blanche with doing anything with my hands that I could get away with.
As he got more comfortable with his costume, he was more daring. And he would work with players, with visiting managers, umpires, to really sort of ingratiate himself to the whole act. And it was just a terrific combination of synergy between the music, the staging, the timing, and his ability to set things up.
I found out later that you become this different person. You start to grow into this personality who you referred to in third person, you know, and you're like a schizophrenic who, if you were cured, you'd lose your job. So, you know, I developed this split personality that worked.
The Fanatic has truly proven to be an enduring and lovable part of Philly's lore. But by 1979, the team needed a real-life hero to put this talented group of players over the hump.
The biggest reason why I went to Philadelphia, to Cincinnati, is that I thought they could win. The problem I saw with the Phillies back in 80 was they were all about the same age, and no one would ever, although Boa respected Wozinski, he wouldn't look up to Wozinski. Wozinski respected Maddox, but he wouldn't look up to it. I mean, Boone respected Schmidt, but he wouldn't look up to him because they were all about the same age. And they needed someone like me who was, you know, 7, 8, 9 years older with some experience. And we just become one unit.
He could ignite and motivate a team as well as anybody by his approach to hitting and his approach to trying to beat that other guy. He played this game day in and day out with the heart and soul that you try to sell to all the guys with great talent.
At least one umpire is always welcome.
Hi, sweetheart, I miss you. Get the Hey, we're on TV and radio now. My wife's here, don't do that.
Eric Gregg, the Fanatic's favorite.
Come on, let's go. Come on now. Ah! Ah! Come on, Blake. Hey, let's go. Come on, base hitting.
Ah! Of course, not even Eric Gregg can make the Phillies swing the bats.
But now in 1980, when Dallas Green was a manager, you know, he would jump on the umpires. He started yelling. Now he came up. I said, hey, what's going on? He said, listen, rerun, bear down. I said, don't ever come to rerun again. He said, how about Fat Albert? I said, you call me that, you're out of here. So now he goes back in the dugout. Now we're in the bottom of the eighth, double play ball. I call Smitty out. Boom, out. So he comes out and he starts screaming at me. He said, you know something? He said, that's terrible. You do something, you'd be a better umpire. I said, listen, I told you that's enough. If you ever call me those things again, you're out of here. So now he goes to the dugout. I don't hear a word. They come back, bottom of the ninth. They're behind by 2 runs. A slow hop by Luzinski. They pop with the ball. Bang, bang, play. I call him out. I don't hear a word. So I walk in the end of the inning. I walk in back in the outfield. And all of a sudden, I hear somebody yell, hey, hey, hey. And boom, you're out of here. I had to be him.
...1980 started out with a great omen as Kite Man finally reached his target on opening night. The ball club bristled under the sharp discipline of Dallas Green, then turned on the Jets in one of the most dramatic stretch drives in baseball history. Night after night, September games ended in miraculous fashion. Then came the gut-wrenching 5-game set with the Astros.
Right center field, Maddox is there!
And the pennant finally came back to Philadelphia. The World Series was a blast, and Veterans Stadium put on her best face. After winning Game 5 in Kansas City, The Phillies were one win away from their first world championship. With a 4-1 lead in the ninth, we all fastened our seat belts as Tug McGraw loaded the bases.
The script is in. We win at the end. We knew what the ending was. We knew we had to go through a lot of things, but we knew what the ending was.
But look, Tug, you know, when we win this game, if you're on the mound, you know how the camera's going to be on you when, you know, after the final out. I want you to wait for me to get in there because I want to get in that picture.
Fans, players, everybody remembered that so well. It was like it just happened yesterday. And it didn't matter whether you were on the 700 level in center field or whether you were standing where I was on the mound or anywhere in between. Everybody felt the same level of joy. There was no contest. Nobody could feel any happier than the next person at that moment.
Pete Rose was going after Stan Musial's National League record for most hits, and now it's the big event. We're playing the Cardinals. The place is jammed here, and we have a press conference set up because afterward we can't have all the media in the clubhouse because it's just too much. And worked with Major League Baseball to get President Reagan to call in. I remember also there was a restaurant owner from South Jersey who wanted to give Pete a lobster because he read where Stan Musial was in town dining on lobster at Bookbinders, so he wanted Pete to get equal treatment. And I said, well, we have to have the press conference first. So we have this big press conference, and we have Ronald Reagan get on the phone, President Reagan call Pete, and it was hilarious the way Pete handled the thing.
Tell the president I'll be waiting in a minute.
And the president's office called to talk to him, and then I saw it on the news, and I thought that was so cool because I actually got the call.
Hello, Mr. Rose?
Yes, sir.
Mr. President's on. Go ahead, please.
Hello? Yes, sir.
Hello, Mr. Rose. One moment, please.
Hello?
One moment, sir.
Maybe the operators went on strike. Good thing you're in a missile on the way.
I couldn't transfer. I didn't know how to do it. And I was just, I was so nervous because I didn't believe it was really the White House.
I got a recording here on that. Yes.
If you hang up this phone, I'll call you right back.
Okay. Yes.
Who's speaking, please?
Pete Rose.
One moment, sir.
I was trying to get someone to pick the phone up downstairs, and they weren't picking it up at the same time.
Larry, I'll give you my home number.
Hello.
Hello.
Pete Rose?
Yes, sir.
Listen, this is Ronald Reagan.
How you doing?
Well, I don't know. I'll tell you. I've had as much trouble getting this line, or a lot. I think I had to wait longer than you did to break the record.
Well, we were going to give you 5 more minutes, and that was it.
All right, thanks a lot, but I never really told anyone that before. Good afternoon, the Phillies.
So we have the press conference, and we're headed back to the clubhouse, and now the media's gone, and there's this 18-pound lobster in this box, you know, these claws all tied up. And Pete takes one look at it and says, that thing isn't going to take a crap on my Rolls Royce, is it?
In March of 1981, the Carpenter family decided to sell the franchise. After assembling an investment group, my dream of running a big league ball club had finally come true.
Set a goal when I was 15 years old to try to operate and run a major league club, and I'm elated.
The following year, a gutsy group of veteran gamers and future Hall of Famers, dubbed the Wheeze Kids, took the National League East by storm.
Drive deep right field. It is out of here, a grand
those guys, you had Rose and Morgan and Perez. Trust me, they knew how to rise to the occasion.
Then we faced off against those hated Dodgers in the playoffs. October 8, 1983 was a night for sweet revenge.
Them and being from the area for me from Los Angeles was just awesome. And also with Tom Lasorda on the other side, who I had battled even in the minor leagues, was just awesome to be able to beat him.
Russell pops it up down the right field line, a long run for Lescano. It's a fair
It seemed almost poetic that Paul Owens, the GM and architect of the great 70s teams, was at the helm for the Phillies' fourth pennant of the century.
And I remember being little, being 10 years old, and going with family, and my mother and my father, and we would walk up and be around all these people. And they're walking up the ramps. It was such a special feel. And the Phillies were it. My mom was a big time Phillies fan. My mom caught me my first foul ball. Jay Johnstone was our guy. And we would come, and every once in a while, my mother would laugh. We would go do the same thing. And she would give me a sip of beer. She'd get the Schmitz beer, and we'd sit there, and I would be allowed one sip, and we'd watch the game. My grandmother would come to the games. She liked Bob Boone. That was her favorite player. And she likes Schmidt because she says, I like the way he shakes his gigi. That's what my grandmother said.
Now, fans in Philadelphia have acquired quite a reputation.
I respect the fans of Philly. I think it was fun to play for. I think they were knowledgeable fans. Obviously, when you weren't doing well for them, you know, they could boo you.
That's the fans. That's Philadelphia. It's blue collar. Demanding hard work, quick to turn against somebody they felt was lazy or not giving their best effort.
Even in some of the bad years I've had here that I don't recall ever being booed, you know.
And here came a box of Pampers on the field. This guy was about 65 years old, and he threw this box of Pampers at us on the field, called us a bunch of babies because we weren't playing good.
I remember getting beer thrown on me and getting spit on a few times.
The fans here, if a guy doesn't hustle, they're like an extra coach. They'll boo the hell out of him to make him run. And you can tell young players that when they come up.
I can remember when, you know, Mike Schmidt was here as well over at third base. There was one heckler there that used to get on him continually, that Mike had those rabbit ears where he would actually hear the guy. He knew that if he went on the road trip, didn't have any hits, the first person that he was going to see once he got back to Beckman Stadium was going to be that heckler.
We had just come off of the Montreal series, and there were some headlines about me calling the Veterans Stadium crowd a mob. Maybe I used the word thug, I'm not sure, but they expected a lot of people and a lot of booing when my name was announced to run out to first base. So I ran out with the wig on and just dumbfounded the fans. The sense that I got was they were all going, you know, like, you know, 30,000 people were ready to boo, and then they looked and they went, what is that? Who's that? That's Schmitty in a wig. Ah, look at him in that wig, you know?
Mike would have probably rather stayed in the clubhouse that day. In fact, some players like to treat the clubhouse like a Motel 6.
Yeah, I remember spending the night here many nights after night games, and we had a day game the following day. And it was a place of refuge.
It was my second home, you know. Had my wine cellar, my locker, you know, so didn't need to go anywhere.
John Kruk used to host many slumber parties in the clubhouse.
I like to be here at 9 o'clock for a day game. I figured, why drive home, you know? So I just stayed here, and shoot, I loved it, man. It was home. This was my home.
Field is basically for baseball. However, occasionally we need to borrow a little of their time. And John, of course, is completely understanding.
Chrissy always needs something, you know. I mean, and, you know, she got the dog and pony show out there half the time, and so I nicknamed her Topper.
Topper, get that stuff off my field, is what I hear on a pretty regular basis, as a matter of fact.
You know, she tops what she did the day before.
Somehow he has a rather limited appreciation for some of our entertainment and pregame shows.
So there's always a battle on who's getting the field, and, you know, what gets in the way usually is infield.
My all-time favorite is when we brought elephants from the circus. The trainer thought it would be a fun thing to make them all stand up. And when elephants stand up, they have a tendency to clear out everything in them that they don't need.
It was real nasty, a lot, and very smelly.
And we had piles of stuff all over the place that nobody wanted to fool with, and they had to get the ground crew out to clean that up.
And we were, for till the end of the season, we're out there with every kind of product known to man trying to get the urine stain out, and that never happened.
I remember Ashburn and Harry Callis on the ostriches, and Ashburn running by us saying, "This thing is crazy, how do you stop this thing?" And the thing is kicking and flipping guys off.
We had to put these mattresses on the field. They were gonna see how many college kids could pile up on a mattress. And there were kids literally with their face was bluer than blue.
I've been dressed as Robin, in the Batman theme. And, oh, I've been ringmasters, I've been soldiers. One year, in fact, Chrissy said, would you be willing to ride a horse?
We used to say there used to be a ballpark here, you know? Now it's a circus, so, you know, Chrissy's a ringleader.
Of baseball is that on any given trip to the ballpark, you may see something spectacular. A one-of-a-kind ball game that people will talk about for years. And there were plenty of those at Veterans Stadium. How about Von Hayes hitting two homers in the first inning as the Phillies demolished the Mets?
Grand slam home run! His second homer of the inning!
Here's the 1-2 pitch. Line drive!
Then, of course, there's the most exciting play in baseball, the walk-off home run.
Long drive! Could it be? It is! A game-winning pinch hit! Home run! Mike Lieberthal! Can you believe it? The Phillies.
It's even more exciting when it caps off a 7-run bottom of the ninth.
Bobby, it could be an inside-the-park home run!
And how about this incredible finish?
The Phillies
them 1-3-2 in the bottom half of the 11th.
And then you get some guys who have to show off and get two in the same week.
Froggy is, without a doubt, the most amazing individual that I've ever seen.
If he was a title fight, they'd have stopped it long ago.
I've been here since the place opened. Seen a lot of great baseball. Had a lot of fun here. Been here for all the great moments. Nice work if you can get it.
From the ground crew. Oh, he is really nuts, I'm telling you. The Fanatic with Wipeout.
I remember going to Fan Appreciation Day. My brother Vince and I would go and, you know, we'd get our little snack pack and we'd walk around and get autographs. They were all sitting in the tunnel and, you know, Johnny Oates. We have pictures with Schmitty and all the guys as well. So they were up there signing autographs on Fan Appreciation Day, which was neat. And I remember, again, it's all the opening days, all the crazy stuff, you know, the Phillies would do with, you know, the Rocket Man and Kite Man and all these things. And so it was unique. I mean, they tried to make it fun here, and I remember really, it was really instrumental in inspiring me to want to become a major league player, so it had a lot to do with it.
Because of this place, I am doing what I love, because I fell in love with sports here. I fell in love with baseball, and I always wanted to be a part of it. And once I realized that I couldn't play in the major leagues, I'd have found an alternative route, and so I chose the media.
Well, I really grew up with this place. I never went to Connie Mack Stadium. I was 5 years old in April 71 when the Vet was opened, and I came here for the very first game, and I'll be here for the very last game. I remember the Fanatic, too, when I first saw the Fanatic, and, you know, I just remember thinking, wow, you know, this guy's got a great job.
'80 was the greatest sports year this town has ever seen. But 1993 holds a special place in the hearts of all Phillies fans. It was a team that had finished last the year before. A group of misfits and cast-offs that nobody thought could win. Nobody but themselves.
25 guys pushing for one thing and accomplishing a goal. You know, and the way we did it, you know, our own special way. With a little pizzazz mixed in, you know, you can't beat that.
They danced their way through the National League East, but had to face the powerhouse Braves for the pennant. On paper, they had no chance, but they didn't play on paper. They played at the Vet. It was one of the greatest finishes in Vet history. And 5 games later, we had our second chance to win a pennant in front of the hometown faithful.
And this place, this joint was rocking now. And this is a very intimidating place to come and play in. And they, you could just feel it. I got chills running up my back right now. It was, what a phenomenal feeling.
I just remember Mitch jumping, and he can't jump, but you know, he really got up off the ground. And I remember Darren running and grabbing, and then next thing you know, it's just chaos. But it was, oh man, it was fun.
Swing and a miss, struck him out. Phillies are the 93 National League champions. This Rocky is wonderful. Bunch of throwbacks has won the National League pennant and go out of the World Series.
People can't grasp that are live around the country or played in other cities, what it's like to win in Philadelphia. The fans here, they feel it with you. They feel the wins, they feel the losses. And see, that's why I enjoyed playing here so much. I love the way the fans react to good and bad. And that's kind of the way I played, see? So I think that's why I got along good in this city. But the satisfaction of not only our club, but to celebrate on this field with those fans, because that's a big part of it. It's not just the players, it's the fans, it's the city, and that was a special thing.
...1993 was a memorable year for the whole collective Phillies family. But individual memories can also be meaningful. On opening day of 1994, my good friend John Kruk had a veteran stadium memory that can never be topped. John was diagnosed with cancer in spring training. His opening day status was in question.
Hour before the game, they said, you know, what do you think? So the doctor, my cancer doctor, came in and he said, you know, he's ready to go. If you want to play him. Larry Shang, you know, kept telling me, you're going last. I said, you know what, let's just do it the regular way. We're here to get our ring. Today's a day to celebrate our championship with the fans. It's not about this. And he said, well, it is about this. Part of it's about this. So let's just, and it was great. I mean, I saw Vuk cry. And when you see Vuk cry, it's something, you know, I thought to myself, damn, maybe I'm not cured.
Pitch, swing, and line shot.
Got lucky and hit a double, and I'm standing out there, I didn't know what to do. You know, the people are standing ovation. I thought, you know, gosh, they're pretty happy about a double. Man, just think if I'd have hit a homer, you know?
John Kruk is a true baseball character, beloved by the fans for his self-demeaning candor and his beer league persona. But there have been plenty of other characters to grace the turf of Veterans Stadium.
I would just do crazy stuff. A lot of it with the mask that started with the cone head, doing little dances. And I think in turn it kept other guys loose. There were some people didn't care for it, but some guys appreciated it more than others, so you would spend more time joking around with those guys.
A lot of the real wackos seem to be closers. Froggy gives us his assessment.
Relievers, I've seen them all. Tug. He was nuts. Bedrosian, out of his mind. McDowell, what a wacko. Mitch Williams, what can you say? Now that Pitalico, he's got potential.
Ricky Pitalico did blossom into a pretty wacky character and an all-star reliever. He was our lone representative in the 96 Midsummer Classic, the second time Veterans Stadium hosted the game. It was a night when one local kid made some big dreams come true.
I'm really walking on air right now to come back here and just participate is one thing, and to hit a home run is another. So can't really describe it. I'm very, very happy and just very honored.
Mike Schmidt, your childhood hero, he threw the first pitch to you. Describe the emotion of that.
You know, just like a dream. I mean, really, I can't describe. And then he wrote on the ball, he just wished me the best and thought I was, you know, he said, you're the best because I think you're the best on the ball. He wrote that there. And just to grow up and watch Mike Schmidt, a Hall of Fame third baseman, and emulate, you know, try to emulate him and become a major league player is just, I'm really emotional right now. I'm really kind of choked up. I don't know what to say.
Now, everyone in baseball knows Philly is a tough town. But in his last All-Star appearance, Hall of Famer Ozzie Smith got a big surprise.
This town doesn't have a great reputation for being generous with their applause and stuff, but you know, it's a memory that will be with me forever. I've seen the picture a million times of where people, the greatest compliment that we can be paid as athletes is for people to come to their feet to applaud and thank you for an effort. And they certainly gave me that, so that memory certainly stands out.
The fans of Philadelphia really showed their class that night, but it didn't surprise me. Through the years, they've always brought a passion and spirit to the vet. Ask any player and they'll tell you, when you bust your butt and you're winning, there's no better place to play. Throughout the history of the vet, the true stars have been the fans.
We Philadelphians tend to beat up on our own, whether it's our own players, our own stadiums, our own politicians. We tend to beat up on our own a lot. I remember in the mayor's box in 1996 for the All-Star game. It was the afternoon of the home run hitting contest. And somebody brought the Canadian ambassador who was up to see some of the Blue Jays players and whatever. He brought him into our box and he was sitting with me and he said, you know, Mayor, he said, straighten me out a little bit. I've read all this bad stuff about the vet. He said, this stadium looks beautiful. And it was early, before the home run hitting contest got underway. And the blue seats were in, the new blue seats, and they looked terrific. And the bunting was there for the All-Star game. I don't know how many people remember that. And the place did look beautiful. And the vet, for its type of stadium, was, I think, a pretty good and serviceable stadium. And look, we all have great memories about the vet. You know, my memories are sports related, but some of my memories are about all of the great things that Bill Giles did in the early years of the vet that made it such a fun place to be. I mean, we take the Fanatic for granted. I've been in a lot of major league ballparks, and there's nothing like the Fanatic in terms of the fun and the spirit he brings to the game.
I'm going to miss this place because there have been the times, I don't know if, now, people just, you know, they like each other's company so much, they can't keep their hands off one another, and they like to find those nooks and crannies at a ballpark on the 700 level. And what's great is what happens is my phone, the hotline rings in the Fanatic's room. Hey, Fanatic, we got a love cup up in the 700 level. You know, that's when you got to go up and, you know, hose them down.
People said this could be part of a healing process. I thought it was very important we came back. I mean, I knew people weren't going to come out here and forget about what happened. No one's ever going to forget about what happened until the day we go into our graves. But I knew it was going to be part of a healing process. I knew that maybe for 2 or 3 hours, people could come out and just get away and put things on hold for a little while. And then obviously you go back to your lives. But I thought that we were very much part of that healing process at that time. The mood in the clubhouse was very somber. As a manager, you know, you're supposed to push and get guys motivated. That was one game where I just really just said, I'm not going to do anything. I'm just going to let it sort of evolve. You know, sometimes we get wrapped up in our own little world, and wins and losses are the ultimate. Oh, God, I don't know what I'm going to do if we lose this game. And during that time, they had the video up there that you think all the moms and dads that lost their lives, the kids without a mom or dad. And it was something that just, they got caught up in the moment. And to see all the flags that night at the stadium was something I'll never forget. And I was here during the World Series game where I thought the emotion there was as good as I've ever seen it. But that emotion that night was, it was a different kind of emotion. It was something that'll stick with me for a long time.
Over the years, we've taken great pride in honoring our past. Veterans Stadium has provided a beautiful backdrop for a variety of ceremonies designed to celebrate our heroes and stir our emotions. Here's a look back at some of those moments.
Tonight is Tony Taylor night. I consider it every time I play in Philadelphia, it's Tony Taylor night. God bless you.
And as you fans know, that I tried with my concentration to block you out and all the external noise in this stadium, but all those years, I was just kidding. I really knew you were here. Thank you all. I love you. You're great.
I'll always miss the goosebumps that I got when you cheered me. I've collected 18 years of those goosebumps, from my first hit back in 1972 to the welcome you gave me here tonight. I don't know where life's going to lead, but the Phillies and Philadelphia will forever hold a very special place in my heart. Thank you all. God bless you. Thank you all.
Just want to say that I came here in 1948. The best thing that ever happened to me, to play here in Philadelphia for the greatest fans in the country.
But nobody, nobody will touch the Philadelphia Philly fans. We love you. Thank you very much.
For the 1993 National League Championship Fight Films.
And now we're poised to start a new era. A fresh, exciting young team will take us into the future, into a sparkly new ballpark with an old-school feel. It is there they will write their own history and start a whole new volume of memory. But just a stone's throw away from Citizens Bank Park will lie sacred ground, a concrete field containing nothing but echoes of the past. Yet for the millions of us touched by this special place, it will live in our hearts forever.
I remember doing a post-game show down in the dugout and just looking out in the stadium, an empty stadium that we just played in, and watching the guys clean the field up and the lights are still on. It seemed like a field of dreams.
And Philadelphia, baseball is a field of dreams. And this surely is heaven down here.
And when you looked up in the stands and saw those people just hugging each other, it was something I'll never, ever forget. To see a whole city, I mean, as I was getting closer to the dugout, I saw tears in people's eyes and the fans. And I said, my God, what do we do here?
How many fans have come here over the years and spent countless afternoons and evenings here and just had a great time. And it's been a wonderful place.
Phillies and this stadium have been a timeline in my life. A lot of good happened here. Kids were able to be kids. And that's what I remember. That's why I look back and I smile.
Veterans Stadium holds an awful lot of memories for me, and it's like home.
We're going to be saying goodbye to a really substantial chapter of Phillies baseball, and hopefully we give all of the people connected with this organization, all of our fans, a chance to enjoy.
It's a place I'll never forget. I mean, there was things that I was able to participate in and be a part of that no matter how much money you have or no matter what you're involved in, you can't duplicate.
I'll be sad when they tear it down just to remember, you know, what all the things we did on this field, all the, you know, the stuff we left out there.
Sometime next year, I'm sure I'll be standing, God willing, I'll be standing in a group of people while the old vet comes down.
Isn't it amazing that a little white ball can serve as a bond between generations?
Baseball is a game to be handed down like a family heirloom.
From fathers to sons to grandsons.
From mothers to daughters.
From the teacher to his pupils.
It's about helping a child's dream to come true.
It's about the veteran helping the young rookie.
And it's about the young apprentice learning from the master.
It's simply the greatest game in the world.
And it's all about connecting generations. I am Pat Burrell.
And I'm Harry Callis. We'll be your host for the 2002 Phillies Video Yearbook.
Connecting Generations.
The Philadelphia Phillies are one of the oldest sports franchises in the United States. The Fightin' Phils. There's a lot of history here. Seems like I've spent most of my adult life on or around this team. I've been through the hard times and I've seen the glory days. My name is Larry Boa and I'm the manager. It's my mission to get you to remember the Fightins.
In between the exuberance of youth and the serenity of the golden years lies a lifetime of memories. For a baseball fan, a million images earmark the passage of time. Whether it's witnessing a part of the game's history or simply making contact with a favorite player, the image is indelible. Who can forget that first look at a big league ballpark? The colors, the sounds, the smells. These are as lasting as the day they first happen. We choose our favorite players by the most subjective means. We like his stance in the batter's box, or the way he wears his cap, his smile, or maybe we just like his name. We admire certain players for their speed, their style, some for their strength. And some for how they play the game. And once we've chosen our favorite players, we revel in their deeds. It may be the star player achieving a milestone, or the steady role player doing the impossible. It may be a key hit in the biggest game of the year, or a late night miracle in front of a few loyal believers. Baseball is all about success and failure. But somehow the script always seems to provide a chance for redemption.
Our ground ball, base hit, base hit, Phils win, and the RBI hit by Kim Batke. This place is going wild.
This is Harry Callis. For almost 30 years, I've been lucky enough to be one of the voices who brought you Phillies baseball. As part of our end of the century celebration, we'll take a look back at the last 100 years of our fighting Phils. From the fabled teams of yesteryear to the great individual performances. We'll revisit all the great moments of the franchise and then finish with the top greatest moments in Phillies history as voted by you, the fans. So strap in for a very special trip down memory lane and have a great flashback.
There was electricity. It was spine-chilling.
For National League playoffs between Houston and Philadelphia were, without question, the most action-packed league championship series in history.
Great athletes, they rise and they get the job done.
You got the feeling that that those games could go on and on and on, like a heavyweight championship bout where both fighters can withstand punches.
This was a real bunch of battlers and people that weren't lovey-dovey to each other all the time either.
This was not the good ship Phillies, you know? This was not a happy bunch of people.
There was such a chip on the club's shoulder that it worked to our advantage. It was almost like we weren't gonna be denied. No matter what happened, we weren't gonna be denied.
We were playing for a lot then, and the object of the game is to win the game, and you have to do whatever you can.
We had 25 guys that wanted to play. We didn't have three or four happy to be on the bench. We had 25 guys who wanted to play.
It's such a trite saying. Yeah, we did it for our fans. It was truly for all of us.
The love affair between the Philadelphia fans and that ball club was something I'll never forget.
My name is Dallas Green. A baseball life can be filled with equal parts joy and equal parts heartache. The prestige and glamour of the big leagues are often balanced by countless lonely hours away from home. But if you're lucky, with a lot of sweat and hard work, you eventually get the taste of glory. In the fall of 1980, I got the taste of glory. Yet glory can be very hollow unless it's shared. That autumn, I shared it with 25 men who would run through a brick wall to win a ball game, with a staff of dedicated coaches who knew what it took to win, with an owner and general manager as close to me as family, and with a few million people who call themselves Phillies fans. These were our glory days. This is our story.
Hi, this is John Crook, and welcome to Veterans Stadium. This place holds a lot of memories for me, and even in its final season, the Vet has proven it can still provide some pretty special moments. Now, I've never been one to pay too much attention to pitchers, but outside of playing in the postseason, there's nothing like being involved in a no-hitter. I was lucky enough to be in two of them.
High ground ball, great grab, Green, it's over, he's pitched a no-hit, no-run game, making the final out himself. Tommy Green, a no-hitter.
Now, Tommy Green had walked so many guys, I didn't even realize he had a no-hitter going until the ninth inning. And it really wasn't that much fun to do it in front of those 30 or 40 people in Montreal. The fun part was when we were all getting ready for the flight home and told Tommy he had to stay in Canada because the Prime Minister wanted to invite him for dinner. In 1990, we were almost on the wrong end of a no-hitter as Doug Drabek took it all the way up to two outs in the ninth. Up stepped one of the most feared hitters in Phillies history, Sil Campusano.
3-2 pitch, swing, and a line drive hit to right center field. I can't believe it. Sil Campusano has singled to right center with two outs in the ninth inning to break up a no-hit bid by Doug Drabek.
No-hitter? Gone.
A couple of weeks later, Terry Mohan did it right. In front of a big crowd, he actually took a perfect game into the seventh until the first baseman couldn't hold the bag. But the defense was solid.
Change up to Thon. There's one. On to first. There's two. There's your double play.
And Terry was nasty.
Plus on their feet at Veterans Stadium. One ball and two strikes. Here's the 1-2 pitch. Line drive, great ball! Charlie Hayes! Charlie Hayes spears it, and Mulholland has pitched a no-hit, no-run game at Veterans Stadium. The first nine-inning no-hitter in the history of the bat. Can you believe it?
Games like that are something you remember forever, whether you're a player or a fan. And on April 27th, we all got treated to a beautiful slice of baseball history. In the following hour, we will take a look back at Kevin Millwood's brilliant no-hitter and relive one of the greatest games ever played on this field of memories.
It takes a lot of dedicated people to run a baseball team, from the executive level down to the clubhouse, from the players to the game day staff. Through the years, a number of colorful characters have worked their way into Veterans Stadium lore. It would take hundreds of hours to tell all of the stories, so here are just a few.
Who was my favorite non-star Philly? It had to be Jay Johnstone. I mean, because Jay made baseball fun. I thought he was one of the great natural left-handed hitters.
Roger McDowell was definitely, in all my years of playing, the craziest practical joker in a clubhouse I've ever seen. He had a collection of a bunch of things, snakes and hot foots. I think Roger was probably the biggest prankster I've ever been around as far as, you know, the hot foots with Vuk. I mean, he got him almost every homestand. And, you know, he didn't have a clue, which is, you know, that's pretty good.
Roger went so far as to punish me for leaving a game too early.
It has been brought to our attention that you, club president, left the game in question in the second inning. We feel that being the head of this ball club, the club president, should stay and support his ball club regardless of the outcome. And the fine for this particular front run is $250. $250?
Bring a lawyer and you fight your case, and you were found guilty.
Yes.
The fine is doubled.
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 The backbone of any ball club is the game day staff, those men and women who work the front lines of Major League Baseball. Thousands of game day employees have passed through the gates at Veterans Stadium and made for a better experience for the fans. Here are some of their stories. Cheryl Spielvogel is a fixture in the stands. For 28 years, she has flung peanuts, served the clientele, and made a ton of friends.
How you guys doing tonight?
We actually made it for the first inning.
Yeah, I know. That's why I'm surprised to see you.
How are you?
I'm good. How about you?
Wes Winnington has worked for the club since the old Connie Mack Stadium days.
Basically, I'm like a Mikey. If someone has a problem, they don't know what to do with it, give it to Wes.
He's one of a large group of game day people that the fans never see. But he's essential for making the Vet as comfortable and as safe as it can be.
Hey, what'd that guy just throw?
Roger on the 611, and we got 611 on the catwalk. You got a scalpered outside of H booth. We've got peanut and soda spill. I believe that's on the cat.
Center host greets people when they come in, sits them down to their seats, and says, enjoy the ball game.
James Daly is a young guy who believes in going the extra mile. Jim likes to throw a few dance moves into his usher duties. These are just a few of the wonderful people that make up the fabric of the Veterans Stadium experience. There are thousands more who deserve much of the credit for making the Vet a memorable place.
The fans here are so great. I mean, I always thought this was the greatest fan base in the country because there's so much passion and they'll boo you, but you don't take it personal. They're booing the performance. They're not happy with it. They expect a lot. And in return, you can't get a better ovation than you get in Philadelphia.
Well, I think our fans on balance are great. They're smart. They know the game. They appreciate hustle. Our fans won't get on a player who they believe is busting their gut. They just won't do that.
You know, a lot of people say it's so hard to play here, but I think it's easier to play here because of that passion. You know when they're giving you everything they've got, you should give them the same thing back in return, and I wouldn't trade for the world. I think they're the best fans in the world.
From Yo-Yo all the way up to Flagman, the Vet has always had its share of unique fans. Tough, passionate, boisterous, the adjectives go on and on. It's a group that likes to wear its emotions on its sleeves, or in some cases, its banners. In the later years of the Vet, a new phenomenon took place, the advent of the fan group. These fans would develop an intense loyalty to one player.
Swing and a miss, struck him out. 12 strikeouts for Schilling, that the biggest of the afternoon.
If he gets anything less than 400, I'll be surprised.
Sometimes friendly rivalries would start up.
The salameter would look like junk compared to the bird's nest.
Junk.
Just wait till this gets
garbage.
Big. Wait till this
garbage.
Gets big.
Schilling's a nerd.
Bird
is the word.
Probably the strongest of the fan groups has been the Wolfpack. Their trademarks are great choreography and an unshaken loyalty. Not even a wedding in the family could keep them from missing a Randy Wolf start.
Have a wonderful time in Hawaii.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Some fan groups have been very clever. We'll be right back. To all you great fans out there, the entire Phillies family salutes you.
Since Bill Giles arrived on the scene, the Phillies have made many kids happy and put a lot of people in the ballpark. However, not all of the club's promotions have been a rousing success. You, of course, remember the world's highest jumping Easter Bunny. Our bunny plans to fly right out of the stadium, landing somewhere in Philadelphia. Would you believe over the mound?
The bullpen probably has the worst seats in the stadium. You just can't see anything from down here. It's terrible.
Now, if I had my way, I'd rather sit up here. These are good seats. They're up high, you look down in the field, you don't miss any action. So I told them, I'd rather sit up here. If you need me, call me.
Try the upper seats at the Phillies games. You'll have a better point of view.
The Dodgers make their final appearance at the Vet for the July 13th weekend. Garvey, Lopes, and Say open Friday night the 13th. Saturday afternoon and on Sunday, it's poster day. All our fans receive a colorful action poster of our team. It's designed by you know who, and it's perfect for your room at home. Here's a great souvenir from the Phillies. So pick one up on poster day, Sunday, July 15th, right before the Phillies face the Dodgers.
Hi, Joe. Hello, Mrs. Dunne. You know, this is a nice hat.
But Timmy, the hat's for kids.
Oh, no.
We asked a few fans, what's a Phillies fan package?
Phillies fan package? No, I don't know.
The Phillies and Tasty Cake are giving a fan package to everybody on Sunday, April 13th.
What is a fan package?
The package consists of a Fanatic poster and button, a litter bag, a game schedule, bumper sticker, decal, and more. Do you know what a fan package is?
Yeah, it's always had too much beer.
Pick up your package Sunday, April 13th. It's for everybody.
As you know, I'm partial to hats, wear them everywhere. So when an item comes along like this, I've got to tell you about it. And here it is, my own design, boys. This red Philly sports cap is adjustable to fit any head, even McCarver's. And it's yours free if you come to the ballpark Sunday, June 14th.
A Philly sports cap for all men and boys on Sunday, June 14th.
I designed it so you know it's a great hat. And if you believe that, I've got some swampland in Bryn Mawr.
What's your pleasure, partner?
Give me a root beer.
Okay, pal.
Hey, where'd you get the glasses?
Got them from the Phillies.
I thought you gave that up.
No, these are world champion Phillies glasses, and you get four of them to a set.
Really?
Just send a check for $10.95 to Glasses, Box 7776, Philadelphia.
Make mine a double.
It's the men's turn, Sunday, July 3rd. Maxwell House and the Phillies give all the men 15 and over this long-sleeve sweatshirt.
Hey, Neil.
Hey, Greg, have you heard about Sweatshirt Day?
Yeah, just what I need for after a game, and I've marked it on my calendar.
Maxwell House Sweatshirt Day for men 15 and over, Sunday, July 3rd at 1:35.
Hey, Tug, what do you really do out here in the Phillies bullpen?
Hey, who do you think does the cooking for these relievers down here? And I'm going to be doing some real cooking this season when I get my Phillies barbecue apron.
Well, Tug, you're not the only one who will get one of these Budweiser aprons, because they're free for all fans 15 and older on Saturday, July 7th.
Hey, that's great. Gotta go.
It's another family event, Budweiser barbecue aprons and Phillies baseball, July 7th at 2:15.
Starting pitchers are the heart of any baseball team.
Relief pitchers are the guts of this team. We don't know the meaning of the word pressure.
Then again, relievers don't know the meaning of a lot of words.
Starters think the seventh inning stretch is a limo that takes them out of close games.
Relievers are airheads.
Starters take bubble baths.
Relievers eat quiche.
Starters play croquet.
Women 15 and older get this great-looking travel bag free. Sunday, May 5th, Phillies versus Astros. Bring a date.
What do? You sit there with the cold one and watch the Phillies on TV. You're supposed to be out mowing the lawn, right? So you get a little heat from your spouse. Next time, come out to the Vet. The game's more fun out here. Sunshine, refreshments, great fans. And there's no lawn to mow. And bring your husband, too.
This Larry Anderson mask free to all fans on Halloween night at the Vet. It's my kind of night.
Children 14 and under, get this free Phillies cap from Dunkin' Donuts. It's just like the one we wear, and it's free.
Who is the fastest player in the National League?
Juan Samuel.
Yeah, Juan Samuel.
They're right, I'm the fastest.
Wrong. The answer is Mookie Wilson of the Mets.
¿Cómo va a ser?
No way.
That's ridiculous.
I walk faster than he runs.
To find out who's really the fastest,
Follow us.
Children 14 and under get free player photo cards when the Phils play the Mets Sunday, April 21st. Bring the whole family.
Get the Phillies feeling. You can see it, you can hear it, you can feel it, it's alive.
Veterans Stadium, Philadelphia, Friday night, August 21st, the Bull Blast returns. Greg Luzinski and Dick Allen in a home run contest. The Dilly in Philly between games of the Phils Dodgers Twinita.
It's alive.
Get the Phillies feeling. See it. Hear it. Feel it.
Phillies baseball. Get it all.
Live it at the Vatican.
Team Shirt Day. All fans 14 and under get this red pinstripe three-button shirt when the Phillies take on the Cubs Sunday, July 31st at 1:35.
Get the Phillies feeling. Got it, get it. At the vet.
Man, the Marlins and the Braves are coming to town. I gotta get ready.
Sheffield, Bonilla. Man, those guys can hit. Maddox, Smoltz, Glavin, Nagel.
Go, Rico, go!
Kenny Lofton, that guy can fly.
Come on, Rico, win! Win, Rico, win!
Right here, grand slam home run, Rico Brogna.
Man, the Marlins and the Braves are coming to town. I gotta get ready.
Maddox, Smoltz. I'm not afraid of those guys.
Cut me, Mick.
Sheffield, Bonilla, Dalton. Remember, Bill, be there for Fan Appreciation Day, Sunday, September 28th.
Come on, let's go. I can strike this guy out. Curveball, no way. I will throw heat. He whines. Here's the pitch.
Fastball threw him away.
Gotcha.
Struck him right out of there.
Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Okay, see you guys. Have a good day. Hey, oh, look at it. There they go.
Come, Nick, you go, we go now. Come on, give me right here.
He gets the back underside of that. Call the cops.
Ow, 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 ow.
Wendell, what a jump. Get back on that ball now, baby. How are you? Look at him. Hey, you got the pitcher hit, and he's going to bunt here. Let's just see what you can do. Yeah. How to get dirty, Mick.
Cut, kid, cut, kid.
Now, let him pick us to finish last. That's fine. Because we will sneak up on some people and bite them hard.
Houston Astros, August 17th, 18th, 19th. Arizona Diamondbacks, August 20th and 21st. Call 215-463-1000.
Come down and see the Phillies July 9th and get a free beach towel courtesy of Modell Sporting Goods.
Hey, don't bogart that drink!
The Phillies, bring on the fun.
Honey,
we're home!
Did you miss us?
Did you miss me?
Come on, give us a hug. What? No kiss?
They're home. The Phillies home opener Friday, April 5th at 3:05.
Get a free Phillies cap courtesy of Modell Sporting Goods. Call 215-463-1000.
Lee, this ballpark's gonna be so great for the fans.
Yeah, there's your little band of Wolfpackers over there.
Yeah, where's Lieberthal's little fan group? Oh, wait, you don't have one, do you?
Get season tickets now and be on the priority list for the new ballpark. Choose your seats, choose your plan. Call 215-463-5000.
Haven't you always wanted to own a piece of Vet Stadium? It's like owning a piece of history.
It's like owning a piece of my soul.
And now you can, by purchasing a pair of authentic, vintage Vet Stadium seats.
Each pair of seats comes with its own certificate of authenticity.
And each carries the unique patina that can only come with the passage of time. Mustard.
Vet Stadium seats are on sale now. Call 215-463-1000 or visit phillies.com.
Nestled in a sleepy little corner of Clearwater, Florida, lies one of the true gems of baseball, Jack Russell Stadium. Since 1955, the Phillies have made this little ballpark their winter home away from home. For almost 50 years, all-stars from both leagues have played in this intimate setting. It's a place of a million memories.
You think about all the great players that have been here at Jack Russell. Going back 50 years to, you know, Mickey Mantle played here and Sandy Koufax and, of course, Mike Schmidt for the Phillies.
Jack Russell's a great place to watch a ball game. The fans are right on top of the action. Sometimes they're too close.
The problem is the spring trainings that I personally had, there was a lot of ground outs and a lot of four-letter words come out of my mouth. And so, you know, some of the fans were a little bit, you know, miffed at my language.
There's a big grill out behind the left field bleachers that fills the whole place with the aroma of burgers and bratwurst. That made it pretty tough to concentrate by the second inning.
But this area right here, this general area here in right field, is actually where we did our stretching and running. So this brings back a lot of bad feelings. You know? To me, it's just, you know, it's nice, beautiful, lush grass, and it was a place for me to take a nap. And so, you know, John Vukovic used to come over and yell at me every morning. You know.
You're a much better player. The fatter you get, the better you hit him. You might be the best fat player I've ever seen.
This is the training room, the door to the training room. We're not allowed in there. Jeff Cooper, the Phillies trainer for 60 years, not allowed in. Equipment room, not allowed in there. Here's the kitchen. We are allowed in here, believe me. I've spent a lot of time in here. Turk, how you doing, Turk? See the kitchen, you know, they got nice water, fruit and everything. Brandon Duckworth in his underwear, always a pretty sight in the morning. This is it right here. Very new, renovated, old, crappy place, but this is nice, you know. My locker was, where was my locker? Yeah, there's a couple old ladies that used to set up here and yell at Mitch every time he'd walk in from the bullpen.
Spring training for old Jack Russell. The Phillies will move into a new state-of-the-art ballpark next year, both in Clearwater and Philadelphia. On March 29th, the last spring training game ever was played there. After the game, fans were allowed to run the bases and create one last memory. Then sadly, one of the nicest little landmarks in Phillies history will fade away.
Thank you.
place where so many dreams were made. And now that we've come to the end of the road, these memories we share will never fade. Sacred ground where so many faithful came to pray. The young and the old were one and the same. We all were a part of so much more than just a game.
Just concrete and steel.